Good morning, how are you? Would you stand with us? We're going to start worship with a new song. Well, maybe not. We may have done it once before. It's 10,000 Reasons. If you're not familiar where we come up with our songs, just you need to turn on the page up. 91.1. And basically what you hear there is what 90.1 is what you're going to hear in here. So won't you join us as we begin?
Thank you. You're the center of the universe. Everything was made in you. Jesus, breath of every living thing. Everyone was made for you.
children to come up to the front for children's moments. Y'all this morning. Good. Isn't something going to happen tomorrow? Is it a big day tomorrow? School starts. That's right. Well, today I want to tell y'all about a little something about Jesus. Jesus had a lot of names people called him by. John the Baptist called him the Lamb of God, takes away the sins of the world. A lot of people call him the Messiah, which is the Savior. But some people called him the King. Well, that was an interesting name to call someone back then, because he really didn't have a castle or a kingdom. He didn't have like an army or a queen or anything like that. But they called him the King of Kings, like the King. And we always think of kings, you know. Today in Sunday school, we were talking about old Disney movies, Prince Charming, and Fair Maiden. I mean, we always think of kings that were noble and all that. But you know, we always think of Jesus as a king, but he really was. Because kings don't always have to wear crowns and have a shield, a sword, and ride on a big white horse and all that, the way we kind of see kings. He's a king because he rules, and he should rule over our life, right? And a lot of times we say that we follow God, right? And that he's our king. And then we call ourselves children of God, right? So if you're a child of the king, right, what would that make you? What's the daughter of the king always called? Princess. What's the son of a king always called? A prince. You know what? That's what you are. You may not realize it, but you are a princess. You are a prince. Because you're part of a royal family. Because when you say yes to Jesus and say, he's going to be my king, that makes you family. And that makes you a princess and a prince. Just like me as a prince. And so, that should dictate how we act, right? You watch enough movies, you know how princes and princesses are supposed to act, right? Act with honor and dignity and all that good stuff. That's the way we should live our lives. And that proves to people that Jesus is a king. It's because we follow him as a ruler. Fair enough? All right, so when you go out today, live like little princesses and little princes, or even princesses. Okay, so far. There's a Prince Charming waiting for you. All right, let's pray. Father, we call you King because we are your children and we live underneath your rule. A lot of times people think kings are about power and rules, but you're about grace and love. Allow us to go out in the world and live like princes and princesses, with honor and dignity that bring glory to your name. So people then will want to be part of your kingdom and make you their king, so that we can further that kingdom and bring more to the family and make the world a better place. Father, as these little ones go to school tomorrow, allow them to shine brightly for what they believe and how they behave, so that others will see and then imitate. And not because of them, but because of you. Father, we thank you and we love you. In Christ's name we pray. Amen. Thank you, baby. This week, we're going to start a series that's actually called The Rabbi. And for you that are biblical people that dig into stuff, rabbi just means teacher. They call Jesus a rabbi. There were many rabbis. In fact, mentioned on many occasions that young men all aspired to be a rabbi. That was the thing to be. When you grew up, you wanted to be a rabbi. You wanted to be a religious teacher. You wanted people to follow you and interpret the scriptures and teach people a way to live. When people would follow you, they would follow you because you were a good teacher. You're a good rabbi. They could understand the scriptures because of the way you taught them. In fact, there's an analogy that says when you follow a rabbi, you should follow him so close that the dust from his sandals should cover you. That's how close you should follow a rabbi. Well, when Jesus came, they called him that, and he was a good teacher. But those that followed him closely for a long period of time knew that he was much more than just any rabbi, that he was something different. Peter got it right when he said, "You are the Messiah." So this week I'm going to read a scripture that really, there's a lot to it. We'll probably even touch on it next week. But this was the way that he taught that people started to follow him. He used parables. He used common day stories for people to understand how much God loved them and the way they should live their life. Today's scripture comes from the Gospel according to Matthew, the 7th chapter, starting with the 24th verse. It says, "Everyone who hears these words of mine and does them will be like a wise man who built his house on a rock. And the rain fell, and the floods came, and the winds blew, and beat on the house, but it did not fall, because it had been founded on the rock. And everyone who hears these words of mine and does not do them will be like a foolish man who built his house on the sand. And the rain fell, and the floods came, and the winds blew, and beat against the house, and it fell, and great was the fall of it." This is the word of God for the people of God. A lot of Jewish people were so ready for the coming of the Messiah. You have to remember it, 2,000 years ago, there were kings that had kingdoms at that time. A lot of them ruled hypocritically, selfishly, and by their own rules. We study lots of kings in biblical history. King Solomon, King David, King Herod. Herod was probably the most known at the time, who was very selfish. In fact, he had killed several wives and even some sons of his own because they threatened his rule. People got used to hearing the word king and immediately thought of those things, of living in a state of fear, poverty, those that had, those that didn't have anything. Kings were very territorial. They ruled under certain areas in the Middle East, and they tried to increase their territory by conquering neighboring kingdoms. They would do this by brute force, with armies, with spies, by bribing, doing whatever to increase their territory. So when you're king, a lot of people became very fearful. So they would pray for the king to come and make everything right, which is the prayer that they wanted. They were praying for Jesus, the Messiah, to come. But they envisioned a great king that had more power than any king ever, that had a larger territory, a bigger kingdom than anyone ever, that would come and wipe out all the enemies and make the world right. This is not the plan that God had. You see, with that kind of kingdom, it's much like the scripture. Those were all built on sand, on people, men that were dishonest and selfish. And as we know, most of all those kingdoms crumbled at some point in history. But Jesus came along and changed everything. He was the new king for a new age, for those that felt they would never be part of any kind of royalty. Many of us watch films over the year. We know what comes with kingdoms. King Arthur, King Andrew, all those. You raise a banner, you wore a crest when you were part of that kingdom. If you found favor with the king, you could maybe even live inside the castle. Or if you lived just outside the castle, you still had privileges and protections and less taxes than those. But you still were under that king's rule and had to live by his laws, whether you felt they were fair or not. A lot of kings would brand and go out and pillage. But this new king that showed up, this carpenter, this rabbi, he talked of a kingdom of love and grace and of acceptance. A kingdom that we still, for some people, wonder where it is. A king that says anyone can be part of this kingdom. In fact, he wants everyone to be part under his rule. His laws are easy. He actually came and said that my yoke is easy and my burden is light. A lot of times we weigh our own self down with laws and lifestyles and things that we do because, honestly, we have other kings in our life. When you have a king in your life, that's number one. It rules all, not just some. I could probably honestly say, if you show me someone's checkbook, I'll show you their king. Where you invest your time and your treasure and your talent and your money, that's your kingdom. And I'll be the first one to be as guilty. About February, our kingdom revolves around a bat and a ball. Some of you may have a different king that you put first in your life. Jesus didn't come to conquer the world. He came to save the world. I used to think the greatest thing when I was a little kid is when we lived in Hot Springs, we didn't have a Burger King. And I was really, I wanted one of those free crowns really bad. But I used to go and they just go, I would like to be the king. And they fold it and put it on your head. I'd have to wait till we went to Little Rock. And my dad would go to Drill and we would go to, and that was the greatest thing, go to Burger King and wear that crown. And just that feeling of importance. God wants you to feel that way every day of your life. Much like I told the children, you are a royal priesthood. It says in the scriptures very plainly that when you say yes to Christ, you become part of a family, part of that royal kingdom. A child of God means you are a prince. You are a princess. But sometimes we forget what that means and how honorable of a sacrifice that our king did for us. You know, a few years ago, I did a youth rally out in the parking lot. And, I watched Braveheart right before that, and so I kind of went with that theme. And so I dressed very Scottish looking. I still had all my hair back then. Well, I remember my hair, so I kind of looked the part. And I remember I was looking for some face paint to, you know, get the war look from Braveheart, and we couldn't find any face paint. So my friend Aaron, who was the youth minister at First Baptist, just grabbed like the acrylic paint out of there and just smeared it on my face. I thought, I'm going to die, because, you know, I didn't know if it'd come off ever. And so we painted it, and there's pictures of me, and I remember going out and I bought this humongous sword. I mean, just, it's about this tall. And I just used it more or less for props. But I hung it in my office for a reminder that I am that prince. That as a man of God, I'm a son of a king, that I have obligations and a duty that come. When you say yes, it's just not yes and we get to go continue living how we've always lived. When you say yes to being a child of God, there are things that we must do. And as a man of God, princes were always expected to defend the kingdom and to bring honor to your father's name. And so it hangs in my office as a reminder of to live that lifestyle, to live one that is honorable. And at times you must defend the kingdom and bring honor to my father's name. Yesterday I've been called to a meeting. I serve on the Tenneco Board of Directors. And the state of the camp was in a very unusual place. If you're familiar with Tenneco, you know that a few years ago Terry Ever passed away. We had been camp director forever and ever and ever and ever. And so there was an uneasy feeling about the state of Tenneco. The person that was the programming director took his place, but it came in light this past year that was not a good fit. and there was going to have to be some changes made. So yesterday, we met as a board for 4 hours and talked about the changes that were made. And for the next year, Kim Carter, who should be Kim Everett, his oldest daughter, will be running CanCo. Now, I know a lot of people may have opinions about that, but I've known the Everetts my entire life. And I said openly, too, that I know Kim very well, and I know that she would do whatever it took and work 110% a day to bring honor to her father's name, both of them, her earthly father and her heavenly father. She is a princess. She lives within a kingdom that is great and mighty, and she knows what it means to bring honor. That's, you can see in her life that she flies that banner of the kingdom that she serves. We don't have to go out wearing matching shirts and flags and all dress alike for people to know that we live underneath the rule of the same king. Your behavior will speak volumes above anything else. We sing songs each and every week about He is our King. I know each week the band, we kind of stress what songs to sing and picking. The reality is that we could sing them all every week, or we could sing the same four or five. But the fact of the matter is we have to live those words first. If we're not really living the words we sing and the words that I say and the words that we speak, that people just say that we're a king of the world of hypocrites. I'm sure Jeremy and I would tell you, if we're not going to live the words that they sing, then there's a whole bunch of other songs we'd rather play. With squeals and rocking and all that. But those words are about a lifestyle that does not bring honor and glory to you. When we go out into the world, it's our opportunity and our duty bring honor to the king, to this rabbi. I found this picture that I actually had blown up, and we're going to hang it there for the next couple weeks. It's a more modern tale of Jesus, what Jesus may look like. It just struck me as I liked it, so we hung it. And next week, we'll keep digging about this rabbi, about this teacher, about this carpenter that for some reason never went more than 100 miles from where he was born. He never held an official office. He really never was a king. He never did anything but talk about love and grace and trying to get people to understand how much God loves you. I know there's days that go by that I struggle even remembering if God knows my name, just because of the way in the world sometimes can be that heavy. But then there's days that remind me how much God does love me. One was actually this morning. I was kind of running around this morning trying to get everything ready for worship. We turned off the bulletins for y'all to have. And a little wee girl about this big goes, "Do you need me to follow those?" And I said, "Yes, that would be great." So she sat back there for 20 minutes all by herself, folded each and every one of your bulletins. That's princess. Things like that remind us how much God loves us. When we go out, we see someone hold a door for as you enter in the building. Little things. Oh, the great, big, mighty stuff is easy to see. But those habits that we do each and every day, where we truly love our neighbor as ourselves, and we go out and we love God with all that we have, all of our heart, all of our mind, all of our soul, all of our might. And that proves to people that you serve under the King. The greatest King that ever ruled. His kingdom will never, ever fail. I have to remind myself all the time that I need church a lot more than church needs me. People have come and gone out of church the last 2,000 years, and it still continues to reign and grow and thrive. Because God is that King, whose kingdom will never fall. About 8 or 9 years ago, an African-American preacher did a very similar sermon about Jesus being king and how you serve. And do you know my king? Because as I said, sometimes people can see that you may serve a different king. And he wanted people to understand about his king. Now, I can't do it with quite as much flair as he can. But it did catch on enough to where they made a little video about it. And so, to make sure I give it due justice, I'm going to end this afternoon with about a reminder of our King, that we serve and love, whose banner that we raise high when we go out and we act with honor and dignity. We carry that love throughout our lives and spread it into those that are around us. For you that are teachers, when you pour them into your students. For you that just work, when you pour them into your co-workers. For even when you spread it into your own homes and your own families. You too then become part of that kingdom. Serve others.
The Bible said, my king is the king of the Jews. He's the king of Israel. He's the king of righteousness. He's the king of the ages. He's the king of heaven. He's the king of glory. He's the king of kings. And he's the Lord of lords. That's my king. I wonder, do you know it? My king is a sovereign king. No means of measure can define his limitless love. He's enduringly strong. He's entirely sincere. He's eternally steadfast. He's immortally graceful. He's imperially powerful. He's impartially merciful. Do you know him? He's the greatest phenomenon that has ever crossed the horizon of this world. He's God's son. He's a sinner's savior. He's a centerpiece of civilization. He's unparalleled. He's unprecedented. He is the loftiest idea in literature. He's the highest personality in philosophy. He's the fundamental doctrine of true theology. He's the only one qualified to be an all-sufficient savior. I wonder if you know him today. He supplies strength for the weak. He's available for the tempted and the tried. He sympathizes and he saves. He strengthens and sustains. He guards and he guides. He heals the sick. He cleanses the lepers. He forgives sinners. He discharges debtors. He delivers the captive. He defends the feeble. He blesses the young. He serves the unfortunate. He regards the aged. He rewards the diligent. And he purifies the meek. I wonder if you know him. He's the key to knowledge. He's the wellspring of wisdom. He's the doorway of deliverance. He's the pathway of peace. He's the roadway of righteousness. He's the highway of holiness. He's the gateway of glory. Do you know him? Well, his light is matchless. His goodness is limitless. His mercy is everlasting. His love never changes. His word is enough. His grace is sufficient. His reign is righteous. And his yoke is easy. And his burden is lighter. I wish I could describe him to you. Yes, he's indescribable. He's incomprehensible. He's invincible. He's irresistible. You can't get him out of your mind. You can't get him off of your hand. You can't outlive him, and you can't live without him. Well, the Pharisees couldn't stand him, but they found out they couldn't stop him. Pilate couldn't find any fault in him. Herod couldn't kill him. Death couldn't handle him, and the grave couldn't hold him. Yeah! That's my king. That's my king.
Father God, we know that you are King, that you reign over our lives, that we live within your kingdom. Allow us to be able to go out with confidence and boldness out into a world and proclaim the King that we serve and the kingdom that we live in, that we live underneath a gracious and loving God that only wants to increase his territory, to change lives within this world, to make this place that we reside for a short period of time just like the eternal resting place that you have created in heaven, where there is no sick, where there is no need, where there is no worry, that all who come are accepted, that all sins are forgiven, that all debts are washed away, all wounds are healed, so that all eyes can be opened and hearts can be changed. Father, allow us to raise that banner high, to go out and live as prince and princesses of the loving King. Father, we end this time of prayer, the prayer that your Son taught us to pray. Father, you are our challenges us to live life will go backwards. We learned today that this king didn't conquer anything for us, but died for us, so that we would have true freedom from all those things. As one voice, let us say our Wesleyan benediction together. May the Lord bless you and keep you. May the Lord make his face to shine upon you and be gracious unto you. May the Lord lift up his countenance upon you and give you peace.
Forgive me.